You're listening to Convenience Matters, brought to you by the National Association of Convenience Stores.
Welcome to Convenience Matters. My name is Jeff Leonard. I'm with the National Association of Convenience Stores, and we are here to talk about things that matter to convenience stores. And if they matter to convenience stores, they matter to consumers, because we get about half of the U.S. population there every day to do all kinds of cool things, whether it's to eat, drink, fuel up, you name it. And I'm joined by my regular co-host.
I am John Eichberg with the Fuels Institute and NACS. As Jeff said, we're here to talk about convenience stores, the things that fuel your vehicle, get you from point A to point B. And you know, those 160 million transactions a day, a lot of them are buying fuel. And lately in the media, we've been seeing a lot of stuff about new things that may actually take business away from the fuel island, electric vehicles, autonomous vehicles, all those things. So we've got our colleague Donovan Woods from the Fuels Institute with us today to talk about these things.
Glad to be here, guys. Thank you.
So the headlines, and I've been talking about this a lot lately, is there's a lot of shiny objects out there, and it can be very distracting. Convenience retailers sell a lot of fuel. 70% of our business is fuel sales, and they are constantly asking, okay, are electric vehicles really the next big thing? Is autonomous? What's going on with autonomous? What do we expect with that? You know, a couple months early in March or late March 2016, Tesla announced and revealed the Model 3. It came a huge fanfare. 180,000 units were ordered in 24 hours. By mid-July, something like 450 to 500,000 units have been sold. Now, they're not going to be delivered until like 2017, 2018, but it really raised a lot of questions. Donovan, what have you been hearing about it? What do you think about the electric vehicle market? What does the Tesla Model 3 mean for that sector?
It's interesting you mentioned the Tesla and just how many vehicles that really means. And just to give perspective to our audience, you mentioned over 500,000 being pre-ordered. Last year, there were only 116,000 EVs sold nationwide. So that would be a dramatic change in the market if they were able to take off and actually deliver more than half of these cars. It would be a big change in 1 year, well, basically 2 years when they actually come out.
Now, it's funny because, you know, everybody's questioning their ramp-up ability. There's a lot of questions about will they be able to actually deliver those cars, Jeff. People are comparing that if Tesla pulls this off, they are comparing it to Henry Ford back in the 20s producing a couple hundred thousand Model Ts over a couple year period. It's a significant feat to undertake. They've never produced that many cars.
And more importantly, when you say Tesla now, to a certain extent, you're thinking EVs. And EVs are not just Tesla. There have been a lot of folks out there for a long time doing some significant work to get us to where we are now. And you hear some of the news about Tesla lately. You had that autonomous driver crash. It was the first fatality with an autonomous vehicle. Tesla hasn't met their production for a couple straight quarters. A little bit of luster has come off them more broadly because it's gone from aspirational to what is happening now. And that's common, I think, as any individual company grows. But I guess the broader question is, when we think about EVs, is it also having an effect potentially on the EV market?
You know, I think the question will be answered. So the big hoopla with the Model 3 is it's a electric vehicle available for low to mid $30,000 range, gives you more than 200 mile range per charge, and it can recharge 80% in 30 minutes. A lot of really positive attributes with that, but it's not the only car that can do that. So the Chevy Bolt comes out later on this fall. It's actually going to be on showroom floors in September. So you can go and buy the Chevy Bolt and drive off the lot, not put down a deposit and wait 2 years. The Nissan Leaf, the next generation Nissan Leaf, is going to have similar attributes and similar price point. So you're starting to see more and more EVs come in the market. So, I mean, Donovan, we talk to our guys in the Fuels Institute all the time. Do we think that the Model 3 is a harbinger of a new EV market, or is it just the tip of the spear when there's so much more going on behind it?
I think the feedback we get is it is the tip. But it's different. When you're talking Model 3, you're talking Tesla. Tesla seems to try to stand off as just being an EV simply because it's Tesla. You don't think of it as an electric vehicle. It's almost like the only company I can compare it to would be when people first got excited about Apple. And it was something unique. It was different. and it felt like you were in this niche group and you wanted to be there. And that's what it seems like when it comes to that particular model or that particular manufacturer in Tesla. But as far as EVs, you look at what happened in Atlanta, Georgia, a couple of years ago when there was a the prices of gas was high and they were able to get a government incentive to help them pay for that car. Sales took off in Atlanta. It was the biggest selling vehicle in that vehicle, but EV in that market. It took off, but it's kind of tailed down now that there isn't that government incentive and gas prices have sort of come back to earth.
And it is interesting. The Apple example that you just cited is interesting because it used to be Apple Computer Company, and they dropped the computer because, first off, they extended their product line, but they didn't want to be thought of as a computer. They wanted to be thought of as something more aspirational. So you don't hear that three-letter word, C-A-R, attached to that one company we just talked about.
Well, aspirational is key. Think about the way Tesla came to market. They brought the Model S first. Now, when I've built the Model S online for myself, it gets to $130,000 pretty quick. But the base model is 60, but doesn't give you the range. So if you're looking at about an $80,000 to $100,000 car, it is a vehicle that was competing with the 7 Series BMW, the S-Class Mercedes, and the Audi A8. It was outselling those for that class of customer. It became an aspirational, oh, if only I could have that kind of car. Model 3 comes out, I can finally have that kind of car. The argument has a halo effect. The Tesla brand has a halo effect over that vehicle. The electric vehicle market, however, will benefit from that attention. And I think that the rank and file automakers who are coming out with similarly equipped vehicles in the next year or two are going to benefit greatly from that attention, but they're also going to have a more fundamental effect on the market. I think it's not necessarily their aspirational cars. They're practical cars. They have an economic angle to it. The typical consumer drives about 200 miles a week. If a car gets 200-mile range, you don't need a fast charger at home. You can plug it into a regular outlet and recharge it 20, 30 miles in a couple hours. And so the economics and the feasibility of it starting to change. Now, the question is, how fast and what might we see happen, and should retailers be concerned about that? And that's the question that's out there for most retailers.
Yeah, I did a radio interview this morning, and we were talking about the latest NACS survey looking at consumer optimism. Optimism is up because gas prices went down. And at the end of the interview, he said, so everybody's happy with low gas prices. I said, everyone's happy if you use gas. If you don't use gas, or you're looking to develop an alternative to that, it's not necessarily good times. And to a certain extent, that where I'm going with this is it has to be frustrating for auto manufacturers or anybody that plays in this space that you are planning minimum 4 years out for your next model from the time you design it till the time it hits the showroom floor, if it makes it that far. And in those 4 years, everything can happen. If you look at what the world was like 4 years ago, you could lay out all these different analogies, but the one that's relevant here is gas prices are a dollar plus lower a gallon. So how do you move more electric vehicles when the main selling point isn't there? And also because of that, the government may be looking at what happens to the other big selling point that it's good for the environment? Do you change fuel standards? So the question, I guess the discussion for both of you is, what next? What does all this mean? Because the EV market is much different than it appeared just a few months ago.
I think when you think about that particular question, Jeff, as Jen talked about, we have that halo effect with EVs and how if Tesla is doing great, everyone else will benefit from it. The biggest thing I've noticed is this. With consumers, you don't buy a car based on what it runs on. You buy a car because you like it. You buy a car because the way it looks makes you feel. So let's say if you can have a particular brand by Nissan or Toyota or Honda that you really love and didn't even think about what it was powered by, then you'd buy it. And sometimes when you're looking at certain EVs, they stand out as different. They stand out as a little bit quirky, and that kind of tends to sway the other way. But if you are a retailer, it is concerning. We talk about that all the time at the Fuels Institute. What should we do? Should we partner with someone? Should we actually install fast chargers? What is going to happen in the future?
I think the role for the fuel retailer traditionally going into an EV market is a couple things. One, by 2030, 2035, EVs are probably going to be 15 to 20% of new car sales. That doesn't mean they're going to be 15, 20% of the cars on the road, but there's going to be a tipping point. I think about 5, 7% of market penetration of cars on the road will quickly move into double digits and 20-plus percent of cars on the road being EVs. And that's not very far away. We're talking 15 years, maybe, before we start seeing that trend really pick up. People tend to be attracted to things with which they're familiar. And as more and more people drive in your neighborhood in electric vehicles, you start going, you know what, their lifestyle is like mine, maybe I can handle it. You know, a couple years ago, we had the Leaf and the Volt. That was the only thing on the market. Right. Now we've got 15 EVs for sale in the United States. From a retailer perspective, there is opportunities. As the battery technology improves and costs come down and recharge times improve, there is a role for convenience retailers to put in a charging station for that 15-minute stop. If a car is going to get 250-mile range and they want to do a long trip, most people don't drive more than 250 without stopping. Stop for 15 minutes, they put another 150 miles onto their battery, then they keep going. If you've got a store that has a dynamic offer that gives them something to do for 15 minutes, they may stop at your store. There's an option there. The other thing is more than half Americans have no access to a garage. So they don't have access to plug in their car. So if EVs do start picking up speed, those retailers who are offering charging stations will enable those consumers to buy an EV and frequent those stores. So we are very early on. I don't think there's a whole lot of demand for in-market charging. But I think in the next 10 years, we're going to see that demand pick up.
Yeah, and it's basically two things are happening at once. The experience at the convenience store is lengthening if you want it to lengthen. And by that, I mean if you want to get a prepared meal, something more like you would have as a restaurant, a longer experience, you can do that. You can still in and out 3 minutes. But if you want, the time you spend at a convenience store is extending. At the same time, the length of a charge is shrinking. So when EV, 2-3 years ago, John, when we were having conversations at auto shows, EV chargers were not talking about gas stations. They were right. talking about malls. They were talking about restaurants. They were talking about apartment complexes, any place where you're going to be for a while. And when you mentioned convenience stores, I said, well, that's too fast. Not necessarily so anymore, with the two trends kind of combining a little bit.
And as convenience stores are becoming much more food-centric, and you know, you talk to a couple of convenience retailers, they say, you know, sometimes we put tables and chairs there, sometimes you don't. Those who put them there, not many people sit in them and eat there, but it provides an image to the consumer that this is a higher-end food establishment. This is a place I can hang out, maybe provide some Wi-Fi. You know, let people come, the Panera model. Encourage them to hang out for a while. The longer they hang out, usually the more money they spend, right? I know I always do whenever I'm hanging out someplace, more money is going out my wallet left and right. So I think the future of EVs has a place with our industry. And right now, early movers, they can find partners to help them defray the costs. 5-10 years from now, it may be all on us. And so there's an opportunity for the first mover advantage here.
And I, going back to another point that Donovan said earlier, talking about how EVs are somewhat less about the car and more about the experience, and thinking as convenience stores add more fresh items, apples, for instance, different kind of apple, not the company. But that also fits in with the type of, as the customers and the food in convenience stores evolves into more fresh and produce and those items, that really hits the sweet spot of who is looking at EV now, because that customer probably is more likely to care about, if they're looking at a cleaner fuel, they're probably looking at cleaner food as well.
Right. And you think about consumers now have sort of changed in terms of, we talk about they're distant, they have their cell phones in front of them, they're not really engaging with one another. That is true. But at the same time, consumers now want an experience with everything they do. So if they go inside of your convenience store and it's an experience for them, not a convenience store, it's a place they want to be, they will go there. Same with an EV or any other car. If the experience gives me what I want, I'm connected, it's what I will try. It does not matter who the brand is, I want the experience.
I think it's also important, you know, Jeff, we've done surveys that younger customers like convenience stores a lot. Mm-hmm. That late teen, early 20s, they love what we have to offer at convenience stores. In 15 years, they're going to be the ones driving, and they will have never known a market when electric vehicles weren't available or viable. And so there's not going to be this, oh, I don't trust it, it's a new technology. That won't exist in 15 years for these kids. And so if that's the future customer of our industry, we need to start setting ourselves up to be able to provide them the services and the power they want for their cars. And so that's something we had to look out for. The other thing we need to be really thinking about, and the jury's out, is the effect of autonomous drive vehicles on this market. And Donna, I know you spent a lot of time looking at the AV market, and you know, it seems to hit the news mostly when something goes wrong, as happened in June. But it is a technology that the government is bullish on, the automakers are bullish on, and it seems to become a lot faster than any of us ever expected.
I am creeping up on my 40s, like within months. And my age range, when you look at surveys, they shun away from the idea of autonomous technology. I'm different. I would love it. I cannot wait till it's mainstream. But then you have something that happened with the death of the individual in Florida, and you go, well, it seems dangerous. But sometimes you have to look at the stats and go, well, how does it work when it comes to just regular you and I driving our own vehicles? Did a little research, and in the U.S., per 100 million miles driven, there are 1.08 deaths. Now, in Virginia, where we're here located, there are 0.87 deaths per 100 million miles driven. In Florida, where that gentleman passed away, there are 1.24 per 100 million. So before his death, there were one per 130 million miles driven by the Tesla or the EV or the autonomous technology. So it's better than what it is with you and I driving the car. So sometimes you have to look at it in a different way and go, oh, well, this could be safe. This is a possibility, and it's going to happen. It's coming.
Yeah, another way to look in that is there's about 30,000 traffic deaths a year. There's been one with autonomous vehicles. Now, right. 30,000 traffic deaths a year works out to somewhere, I think, between 80 and 90 deaths a day, every day. And this one AV fatality, it has captured greater attention than a lot of these others because it's different. But that's what happens when things evolve. And I don't think you're looking at those numbers. I don't think there's any indication that there is anything changing the discussion about safety in AV being an entirely new dynamic going forward.
You know, same thing happened a couple years ago when an electric vehicle caught fire. It was news. I don't know how many times you guys have driven down the road and found a car on fire. I've seen trucks on fire, RVs on fires. It's unfortunate, but cars catch on fire. But if it's an alternative fuel vehicle, it's going to get a lot more attention. The interesting thing about safety of AVs is the 30,000 death per year metric you use. Department of Transportation uses that metric as evidence of the need for autonomous vehicle. And there's different levels of autonomy. The Google model is an independent autonomous vehicle, which is scanning the market constantly and reading conditions, not communicating with other vehicles. Most technologies I've researched is the cars are going to communicate with one another. That's not happening right now because there's not very many on the road. So think about it, though. Once we get to a point where vehicles are able to communicate with one another and tell each other, hey, we need over, we're coming this way, give us some room, and the cars having the computers at this point, have no ego. And they go, all right, come on over. It's not like you turn on your blinker and the guy in the lane next to you slams on the gas to block you out. That's not going to happen in a fully AV or predominantly AV market. But we got ways to go. And I think, you know, Donovan, you mentioned social adoption of it. Again, the next generation isn't going to know anything different.
You mentioned machines with egos. So that makes it sound like some of your my toaster has an ego. I don't know about.
Look, you know, all I'm going to say is that Mr. Gates, Mr. Musk, and Professor Hawking have all signed a letter advising the governments to be very careful about setting up the regulations to control artificial intelligence, including AVs.
Well, so
Skynet.
Watch out for Skynet.
Away.
Watch out for Roadnet. And keep listening to Convenience Matters.
You've been listening to Convenience Matters. brought to you by NACS. For more information about the National Association of Convenience Stores, go to nacsonline.com.